really it's my pleasure to be here to introduce Megan McArdle from her base here in Washington, D.C. She's been blogging now for more than a decade, focusing largely on economics, finance, and public policy, and establishing herself as one of the most influential bloggers on the way. In her career so far, she's moved from being associated with one first-rate publication after another, starting with The Economist, and The Atlantic, and Newsweek, and The Daily Beast, and since last year, Bloombergville. Now that list makes it sound as if Megan has known only one success after another. Indeed, as she notes in the preface of her new book, she's had a pretty great life, which has included not only a great job, but a great husband, a row house in the U.S. Capitol, and an adorable puppy. So, why write a book, as she's done, about failure? Well, as I'm sure she'll explain in a minute, there is more to her own story, including some personal setbacks and some periods of real misery, all of which has contributed to an illuminating, engaging book that combines recollections of Megan's own experiences with lots of research and insights from others. Megan has titled her book, The Upside of Down, which pretty well reflects her basic upbeat message, namely that as much as we fear failure, it can prove the best thing to ever happen to us if we handle it right and learn how to turn it into an opportunity. That's an important lesson, as Megan makes clear, not only for us as individuals, but also for us as a society interested in fostering risk takers and embracing experimentation. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Megan McArdle.
You guys are my first book talk, so forgive me if I fail, although I guess I will have just then proven the point. A lot of people, when you tell people that you're asked writing a book on failure, the first thing they ask you is why? Why this topic? And, you know, the answer I always give is, it's write what you know. And sometimes they think I'm kidding. Sometimes they're like, oh, yeah. But, you know, I've reached the period in my life where you start to look around and look at all these incredibly successful people and compare yourself to them. I mean, and like now these days, I think, you know, by the time that's always my age, I've been dead for 6 years. And so you start comparing yourself and you start saying, wow, like, look how little I've done compared to what I expected. And then you look at someone like Julius Caesar, who comes across, at the age of 40, comes across a statue of Alexander the Great in Spain and basically goes into hysterics and has to be hauled off by some of his aides because he can no longer cope. And as he's sitting there sobbing and they're saying, Caesar, Caesar, what's wrong? I mean, he says, well, you know, look, I'm 41 already and I've accomplished nothing with my life. It's over. I failed. It's, you know, everything good is behind me. And so part of the reason that I decided to write this book is that, as I like to say, I'm like the Paganini of failure. I've worked for startups that failed. I was actually so good at picking startups that failed in my 20s that I had a friend who was an equity analyst just starting out, and he said, if you get an offer from one of my companies, can you please let me know because my boss needs to short the stock? And I went from there to, through a series of companies that went out of business, I decided to go to business school. And I got out of business school in 2001, and I'd been a technology consultant, and so I decided naturally in 2000 that I should take a summer job in technology banking at Merrill Lynch, which, despite the fact that I'd actually watched the NASDAQ plummet from the lobby of Merrill Lynch when I was doing orientation, but it seemed familiar and comfortable. And then I realized that there was no inner investment banker waiting to get out of me. And so instead, I took a job in technology management consulting. So I went to, as I was preparing, in business school, you recruit in October of your second year. So you're basically done by November. You know where you're going to go work. You can just spend the rest of your time relaxing. Although some would say that that's what people do in business school for 2 years. So I have this job, and then around May, I planned a trip to Spain with my boyfriend. They call me and say, look, you know, business is a little slower than we thought, so we're just going to push it off the back. Just just until, like, you know, you were starting in October, we'll switch back to February. So I called my, canceled the trip to Spain, called my parents and said, Mommy, can I move home? And so I moved into my parents' spare bedroom, which luckily was well located in Manhattan due to good real estate choices in the 70s. And I waited at Top Rings to interview, and then happened. And I ended up working down at the World Trade Center disaster recovery site because, as a libertarian blogger, the supreme irony of my life is that my father was a lobbyist, and was a lobbyist for the heavy construction industry, and so his clients were involved down there. They needed some help, so I went down there and I spent a year there. While I was there, I started a blog, and then the management consulting firm called and said, we're going to push you back just a little further. How about May? And so I kept working there, and then they called again, and they said, we're going to push you back. How about never? Does never work for you? So I made, at this point, a very bad decision, which was that instead of saying, oh, I'd better go find a job right now, I spent another 6 months down at the World Trade Center site. And I don't regret having done this from a civic viewpoint, but I do, it was not a good career move, because by the time I got out, I was competing freshly into the MBAs from two classes behind me. And so I went through a series of trying to find a job, and around about May of 2003, I was really, really desperate. And I actually went out to an event with business school classmates, but I didn't have any money, so I couldn't buy a drink. It was a happy hour. And so I just sort of grabbed a glass of water and wandered around for an hour and a half, and it turned out everyone else had jobs, and they were getting married or having babies, and I was living with my parents and not so much employed. And at one point, a guy I didn't know very well walked up to me and said, how are you doing, Megan? And I said, I'm perilously close to despair. And the look he got, I was just sort of staring at me, clearly had no idea what to say, and eventually just sort of sidled away, because I think he was afraid to turn his back on me. And then 2 weeks later, Andy Gottlieb from The Economist called, and this was one of the many, many things that I had tried. I had interviewed for a job at The Economist, I had a small business consulting, I had applied for the Foreign Service, and passed the exam, and gotten all the way, and then for the medical, it was an endless litany of things I was not allowed to do. And he called up and he said, this is Andy Gottlieb from The Economist, and I will not inflict my bad British accent imitation on you. And I said, hi. And he said, how are you? And he said, well, actually, I've called to offer you a job. And I was like, I'll take it. And he's a very reserved man, Andy Gottlieb, and he was able to take me back. And he said, oh, well, that's very nice. We were thinking of paying you $40,000 a year. And I said, you're going to pay me? And then I realized that sounded idiotic. So I said, $40,000 a year, that sounds lovely. And we arranged it. And I called up the guy who was standing at the time, and I said, I got a job. And then I burst into tears. And I'm not really a teary person. I've only ever cried in happiness one other day in my life, and that was on my wedding day. And my parents, when I announced that I was deciding to become, I decided that I was going to pursue this wonderful new career in journalism, at a job that paid a third of what I had been making, supposed to make at the management consulting firm. And that also, as many of you have noticed, is not exactly one of life's most secure career paths. My parents were a little taken aback. My father said, how would you do this as a business school problem? And I was really... He said, no. And I was like, well, you know, I would project the cash flows, and I would discount by them some factor, and I would get an avenue to do that. And so I did, and as I recall, it had, like, the same expected value as becoming addicted to crack. But I did it anyway, which may be how some people become addicted to crack. And here's what I realized much later, after all of the misery, because I really was extremely miserable. Being unemployed is about the worst thing that could happen. If you look at research on this, if you look at life events, and this is in Germany where, you know, they have lavish benefits and so forth, you know, after people are widowed, they get sad, but then they habituate, and 5 years later, they're about as happy as they were before, so they're divorced. Then you look at unemployment, and it's just, it goes down, and it just stays there. Unemployment is about the worst thing that can happen to you in modern democracy, short of death or disability. And that whole period, that whole 2 years, was really one of the worst periods of my life. And yet I also realized later, because I've been very lucky in my career, I mean, I've worked at amazing publications. It's going to sound really corny, but when I tried to convince my parents that this was really an incredibly wise move, I said, well, you know, if I worked really hard, maybe one day I could work with The Economist or The Atlantic, and those are the first two places I worked. I would not have had the courage to do that, right? I had $100,000 in student loan debts. I had to make $1,000 a month in payments on a $40,000 salary, and I had to live in Manhattan, or near Manhattan, because that's where the job was. And as I was sitting there in year two, eating things like ramen and cheese noodles surprise for dinner, or the surprise is that you're 30 and still eating ramen and cheese noodles for dinner, it was really difficult. I wouldn't have had the courage to do that if I had better choices. And so, but it was, I make this sound like this is something I only did because I didn't have any, like, if you had asked me, sort of, in 2001, would you like to be an economics journalist and spend your entire life interviewing incredibly smart people who will tell you all about everything they know, and then you get to write it down and, you know, talk to readers and go, give fun talks in front of, at least we hope it's fun, in front of people, I would have been like, yes, that's the most amazing job I've ever heard of. But with the low pay, I'm not sure I would have, if I'd had a secure position, I'm not sure I would have had the courage to do that. And so the reason I wrote this book is a little bit because I wish I'd had a book like this when I was going through it, and someone could say, you know, this is totally normal. This is not something that... because having gone to a top five business school and so forth, I sort of felt like once you punched all the buttons, you were supposed to get a guarantee, and that would provide you with a good job, and everything would be fine forever because you did what you were supposed to. It's a very common attitude among my class. You've never seen such a bunch of whiners as Chicago graduates who have been told that unfortunately no one's actually going to guarantee you that job for life. But having gone through all of that, what I realized is, I mean, it really is true that freedom is just another word for nothing left to lose, right? These moments, and you talk to entrepreneurs, you talk to athletes, you talk to, I was on television yesterday with like 9 television hosts saying, oh my God, getting fired was the best thing that ever happened to me. And when you look at the phrase, the best thing that ever happened to you, and you Google it, you get all of these incredibly surprising results like cancer and going to prison, getting divorced, getting left at the altar. But in fact, if they're handled right, these can be transformative moments where you dare to do something that you would never have done had you were, while you were in that secure, safe track. And on the macro level, Joseph Schumpeter, an economist, coined this phrase for what we do in the economy level, which is creative destruction. Old firms, old ideas, old products, they die. They're supplanted by something that is better, that is more suited to the current environment. But it is destructive, and it doesn't feel good. The thing that I realized in the course of first thinking about this book and then ultimately writing it is America's really good at creative destruction, right? In France, if an industrial concern is going down, the government's like, full court press, let's buy it. In America, well, GM aside, in general, when a big industrial concern is going down, it just goes down. It goes into bankruptcy, it gets reorganized, or it gets liquidated. But it's not enough, right? Like, conservatives are very good about talking about letting things fail, and they are right. You need to let things fail because that is how you get the new thing. That is how you discover the uncharted territory. But it's not enough to just let something fail. It actually matters a lot what happens afterwards. It matters for you as a person, and it matters for your organization, and it matters for the economy. It's not just enough to, like, shove the baby bird out of the nest and be like, fly! If it falls, you have to pick it up so it can try again. And so the core of the book is, after failure has happened, after we have experienced all of this wonderful creative destruction, what do you do then? What are the rules for failing better? Not just take risks, which you should, but how do you then get up and go again? So one of the things that of course, occurred to me as I'm writing a book is a lot of writers procrastinate. We procrastinate a lot. We procrastinate like Olympic level procrastination. Anyone who is in the room and who is not a writer and thinks you procrastinate, you have no idea. I once asked one of my colleagues, Josh Green, who writes these amazing 10,000 word profiles of politicians, I was in awe of him because I was writing these little dinky 2,500 word reported features for The Atlantic, and it involved a process where I would spend about 5 days rolling around on the floor and whining to my husband that I was a terrible writer and no one would ever want to read anything I wrote and I couldn't possibly do it. And so I finally went to Josh and I was like, how do you do this? And he said, well, you know, I put it off for about 3 weeks. Then I got clean the garage. And then I go upstairs and I tidy up my office. And I come downstairs and talk to my wife about how bad a writer I am. And then I go back to write. And what I then realized at this moment is that we all do this, is we put things off and why. So I developed eventually a theory of why we do this. And the theory is that we were too good in English class. So bear with me. If you've always succeeded, if things have always come fairly easy to you, which is true of most writers, right? Like, to get to the point where you were employed at a major publication as a writer, you were probably the kid who found English class super easy. While your classmates were struggling, you were writing a YA novel for your eighth grade project, right? But then you get to the point where everyone is that kid. Suddenly, you're not special. And suddenly it's not easy anymore, because you're being asked to perform at an extremely high level, where the standard, the minimum bar, is now being set by that kid who is the best kid in his high school and college English classes, and the star of his college paper. And suddenly you get gripped by this terror, right? Before you write it, it's good, it's great, it's in your head, it's perfect. It's this giant, beautiful tangle of ideas that all makes sense, and then you start to write it down, and it's a disaster. Suddenly, the sentences don't come out right. Suddenly, your ideas turn out to have giant, glaring logical holes. You realize there's 5 interviews that you should have done, and you don't have time. And so you tend to put it off, because as long as you haven't written it, it's still good. There's a great quote from Alain de Botton who says, "Work finally begins when the fear of doing nothing exceeds the terror of doing it badly." And so I floated this theory to a psychologist by the name of Carol Dweck, who does research on how we handle failure. And she said, exactly. So Dweck did really interesting experiments where she's looking at people, she's giving people tests over and over again. So you take someone and put them through 3 or 4 tests, and seeing how they react. And she has one group of people who is getting better with each iteration. And then she has one group of people who is either not doing as well or even kind of regressing. And she's struggling to figure out what's the difference between these two people. She can't really pick them out ahead of time. She's going over the data with the research assistant. She's at Columbia at the time. She's now at Stanford. Suddenly she has this eureka moment where she says, the people who are growing are telling us is that they think of failure as an opportunity to learn something. That's how they identify a new skill. The people who are not getting better are the people who think of failure as a kind of a dipstick, right? It's a measurement. When you do a task, it measures whether you are innately talented or whether you are not. So you think of it as like the fixed people, because they think that talent is a fixed quantity. Those people, the fixed people, don't challenge themselves, and so they don't learn. They are afraid to find out that they are not good enough. And so they deliberately restrict themselves to easy tasks. Or in some cases, the concept called self-handicapping, where you can see people who have been given, say, a test, and they don't know how they did it. They get the one experiment, they gave them a test, it was literally impossible to answer correctly. The questions didn't really make much sense. And then they randomly scored people out of high. And so they took the people who had scored high, and they then told them that they had done really well, and they're going to give them another test. So these people then had the choice of taking a performance-enhancing drug or a performance-inhibiting drug. And a lot of them took the performance-inhibiting drug. Why? Because they didn't know, they didn't feel like they actually had control over the outcome. They didn't know, they felt like, I'm really talented, but I don't know what I did. So I'd better not find out that I'm not that talented. I'm going to give myself an excuse, right? And you saw this in high school, right? With the kid who gets drunk the night before, the really smart kid who gets drunk the night before the SATs, or who just doesn't do the work, right? They're protecting that image of themselves as brilliant. As long as they're not trying, then they won't really have failed. And that is how most of us, at least in some aspects of our life, handle failure. As long as we aren't trying, then we could still be good. We could still not have failed. This is the most dangerous place we can be in, right? Because this is where we stagnate. This is where we're not creating new, anything new. We're doing the same things over and over again because they're the things that we know we're good at. And so failure is not just how people learn. That's how cultures and societies learn. So how do you create, how do you recover from that? How do you encourage yourself? Well, I mean, so I was talking to Carl Dweck, and I said in the middle of this, I have to tell you, I'm a fixed mindset person. I hate doing new things, because then if I'm not good at them, I feel really stupid. And she said, oh, me too. And I was really shocked. She said, yeah, you know, it took me a while. But then one day I found myself saying, oh, wow, I suck at this. This is fun. And I realized that I changed. And, you know, a couple of people have asked me, like, is this a self-help book? And I think that's sort of a weird question, because I don't know why everyone hates self-help books. I don't know about you guys, but, like, I could use some improvement. And I noticed that all of the people at sneering at self-help books, they don't all seem to be, like, you know, 6% body fat with perfect marriages and so forth. But for me, this actually was a self-help book, at least for me, because what I've noticed at the end of this, including when I was writing chapters that I was struggling with and thinking, I don't know what I'm doing. I've only written one book. And, you know, was to say, oh, well, the first time, I'm not going to know what I'm doing. I'm going to have to find out. And so when I talk to young writers now, because I see so many young writers who just completely sabotage themselves by not doing self-help. And it's not, and these are people who graduated from college, so it's not that they're just lazy and incompetent, but they're afraid. And so what I say is, you know, you have to give yourself permission to suck. You have to say, you know what? Like, it's, you can rewrite garbage, you can't rewrite nothing. And this is just generally true, though. This is not just true of writing. So now to broaden this out a little bit, there's a great experiment that a guy from Palm did. And he does over and over again. He does this with various groups. He takes spaghetti and tape and asks people and gives them 25 pieces of spaghetti, some tape. He says, build the U group, build me the tallest structure that can hold up an egg. And so he does this talk. It's great because he talks you through, you know, who does well, Singaporean engineers, who knew. Worst group, MBAs. Apparently, we spend all of our time arguing about who's going to be, like, in charge of Spaghetti Corp. But there's a surprising group that does better than anyone, and it's kindergartners. And you see the pictures, and they're like, modern art sculptures or torture devices or something. They're really, really strange. I mean, Singaporean ones all look like the Eiffel Tower, right? These are like, it looks like a monster. But it holds up an egg. It does what it's supposed to do. And how do they get there? It's because, first of all, they're completely unafraid of failing, right? They're five. They don't know any better. They don't know that failure is shameful. They have just finished learning to walk, which they accomplished, as any of you kids know, by falling down a lot. And so they just, first of all, they don't think that there are rules. So they're the only group that asks for more spaghetti. And there's no rule saying you can't have more spaghetti, but no one asks. But the second thing that they do is just rapid iteration. If it works, they do more of it. If it's not working, they stop and undo whatever they last did. And so by that process, they're failing fast, right? This is the Silicon Valley concept that a lot of you have probably already heard, but it really works. When you fail fast, you're using iteration and experiment to get there faster than you possibly could by trying to think it out, because you're doing something you don't know how to do. Think about how many of you know how to play tennis, right? Learned when you're at least a little bit, you don't have to be. Right, so you remember when you're hitting a tennis ball, you can't really sit there and just develop an elaborate theory of tennis ball physics. I mean, you can, but it's not going to do any good whatsoever. The first time you hit the ball, it's still not going to go anywhere near where you think it's going to go. The only way that you learn to hit a tennis ball is by hitting it about 1,000 times, and the first 999, it's like off in the woods, and you have no idea how that happened. And then the 100th time, oh, that worked. And you still don't know quite what worked. The next two times you hit it, but then you get more and more hits. And that's how you learn a physical task, but it's also how we learn anything where we're doing something that we don't know how to do. Failure is what happens when you are doing the unknown. And you can tell yourself that. And that's what that Carol Dweck's work shows, is that if you actually make yourself think of this, first of all, as both success and failure are a process. They're not the end. And that's a very difficult lesson to teach ourselves. Failure is very aversive, and there's a reason for that, right? Evolution doesn't want you to keep doing things that you failed at, because they're not working. This is nature's way of saying stop. But if you think of it as this is part of the process of iterating and discovering, you really can change the way that you think about it. You really can actually train yourself to broaden your horizons and, as Theodore Roosevelt said, to dare greatly. You can make yourself do it, and you can make yourself pick yourself up faster, because the thing that you see over and over when people have failed is how many people get stuck in that. They just get into an agony of self-recrimination. I mean, so personal finance, which I write about a fair amount, one of the things that's sad and interesting is that people who are in really deep trouble stop opening their books. So why do they do it? It's not, it doesn't make them go away at all. But they, that feeling of confronting themselves and what they feel like is their own complete personal inadequacy is too much, and so they stop. And this is a self-protective measure, right? You encapsulate yourself in your failure by, A, feeling bad about yourself and telling yourself that you're a failure, and then, B, not actually confronting what's causing it. So how do you pick yourself up? First of all, you forgive yourself. Blame is useful in the sense that you have identified what's gone wrong, but not when you're characterizing you as a person, right? It's not very helpful when something has gone wrong to say, oh, Peter did that. Peter must be a terrible human being. Let's all talk about how terrible a human being Peter is. And yet, that's like our first instinct. It's our first instinct with ourselves, but it's also our first instinct with anyone else. I mean, one of the things about the financial crisis, right, is the entire argument over the financial crisis has been over which particular villain did this to us, right? Was it the banksters? Was it the government bureaucrats at Fannie and Freddie? Was it greedy people buying houses? The one theory that gets almost no currency is just that maybe sometimes systems get into bad feedback loops, and we all got the same bad signal from the fact that housing prices were rising. And yet when you talk to people who were buying houses, when you talk to bankers, when you talk to regulators, what you hear is they were all getting the same bad signal. 20 years of rising house prices have screwed up everyone's data, right? Everyone's parents were telling them that a house was the safest way to save for investment. And the regulators thought that they had gotten super smart. So there's a great SEC meeting in 2004 where they decide to allow the banks to take on more leverage, which is to have any amount of assets more debt. So obviously in the same way that having a 1% down payment allows you to buy more house than having a 20% down payment. Similarly, allowing the banks to take on more leverage allowed them to get more risky. And the same thing happened to them. That happened to people who bought houses with 1% down payments. But when you talk to the SEC regulators, right, what they say is, well, we had all this data showing us that the economy was safe, and we've been doing this amazing job. There was a concept in economics called the Great Moderation, which was basically the idea that regulators were now so super smart that we couldn't have anything like the Great Depression anymore. Oops. And similarly, the bankers, when you talk to them, they were looking at 30, 40, 50 years of data that said there is no such thing except, they would always say, except in the Great Depression, we've never had a sustained nationwide decline in house prices. And they're looking at a record 20, 25 years of falling defaults on mortgages. So they're getting data that what they're doing is safe. Everyone is getting the same data that what they're doing is safe and smart. And the end result is that it was the most unsafe thing any of us had ever done, right? We almost completely destroyed the world economy. It's a really unpopular explanation. I see some people getting angry. But, I mean, what's interesting to me is that when I advance this, and there's a guy named Sean Willens at the Fed who has been advancing this theory for a while with some pretty good backup, it's not that people argue that you're wrong, because I may be wrong. I mean, this is not, there are alternate explanations that also have some people. But then people say you must be bad. We're defending the bad people. This is a really deep instinct, right? Is that when something goes wrong, it is because someone did something wrong. Someone did something bad. Someone did something that they knew they shouldn't have done. But if we look into our own lives, and if we look into organizations we've been in, has anyone ever been in a company that fails? Right. No one in the company was like, hey, you know, it'd be awesome if I was unemployed by Christmas. And yet, you can look back and see the group making a lot of really stupid decisions, and you can see your own role, and certainly I can. But when it's other people, it never occurs to us that maybe everyone was just being kind of dumb. not bad, not particularly immoral, just they didn't see it. But the universe is an incredibly complicated place, right? Like, a realistic model of the universe is the universe. Anything smaller than that, we're abstract. We're making a model of the universe, and sometimes that model just goes wrong. It's very hard for people to accept. It's very hard when something bad has happened to you to accept that maybe you just made a mistake. And so one of the chapters of the book I devote to talking about the difference between an accident and a mistake and a failure and a disaster, because they're four different things, but we tend to conflate them. To go back to process, we tend to look at things, when things bad things happen, we tend to think, oh, that's because someone did something bad. But in fact, if you look at something, you know, taking calculated risks, sometimes you make the right decision and a bad thing happens anyway. A doctor can do everything right, and a very premature child can die anyway, even if the team was giving them the best possible medical care. On the other hand, just as I went on book leave, my mother's appendix burst, and I write about medical error for a month, and I watched error after error after error after error made. And then it didn't matter, because she was taking an antibiotic called Tegacel, and as one pharmaceutical researcher said to me, when I told him what I'd been going through, he said, oh, Tegacel's a monster, kills everything. And indeed, it's true. It killed all of the bacteria that were colonizing her abdomen, and she was totally fine. It took a while, but she got back to 100%. But in the medical system, how do we handle that, right? In the first case, if your premature baby dies, or if your child has cerebral palsy, you're very likely to sue a doctor because something terrible happened. And in the second case, when nothing terrible has happened, but it very well could have, because I watched people walk into my mother's hospital room and not wash their hands, and then slap on gloves and start treating them over and over and over again, and I could see that they were doing it because the hand-washing stations at the hospital were inside the room and not outside of the room. I watched people not drain her surgical drains for 3 days, and when my sister and I asked them why this was not happening, say, oh, it's fine. I watched a series of really quite bad mistakes that were pointed out and then ignored. And it didn't matter. So we tend to treat the outcome when what we should be treating is the process. What you want in healthcare, and I know we have at least one doctor in the room, is a good process, because the process is how you make sure that, on average, you get good outcomes. So an accident is something where you got a bad outcome, but you didn't do anything wrong. If you're walking down the street and a refrigerator falls on top of your head, because someone was trying to raise it into a house and it dropped. Like, what lesson do you take from that? Don't walk down the street. I mean, you may think, I really wish I'd stopped at Starbucks, but there's not really a direct lesson that you can take away from that. On the other hand, if you are running a nuclear plant and you have a near miss, that should not be a sign that, hey, everything must be okay. We had a near miss, but we managed to pull it out, so let's carry on. And yet, when you look at the Challenger disaster, for example, that's exactly what you see happen, is that they kept having things go wrong on their space shuttle, and instead of saying, things are going wrong, we don't know why, we'd better stop launching shuttles into space until we've figured it out, they would say, things went wrong and nothing blew up, so I guess that's okay, let's launch again. And that's really common, because again, the universe is complicated, and a realistic model of the universe is the universe, and so we rely on heuristics. And the heuristics that we rely on, which probably work pretty well in the savannah, are, did something bad happen, or did something bad not happen? But in a modern complex economy, in a modern complex world, we need better heuristics. We need to be much more focused on process, and much less focused on whether something bad happened in this particular time. So I'm going to close off by talking about what is probably the greatest disaster happening in America today, and what I led off with, which is unemployment, and how we're dealing with that. And the answer is mostly that we're not, right? People who become unemployed, there's some very good research that was recently done on the jobless. Because what's happened now is that the job market is segmented. I'm sure a lot of you have already read about this. Which is that you have people who are unemployed for a short period of time and they're having pretty much, the job market for them is pretty much like it was 5 years ago. They don't have much trouble getting back in. But people who lost jobs and have been unemployed for more than about 6 months, they can't get a job again. They're just stuck. And having been there myself, I can attest to the fact that this is really one of the worst things that could be happening to them. And it's bad for them, and it's bad for the economy. But the way that we're thinking about it, and they're thinking about it, is that they focus on the outcome, right? They try very... There's very quick job search activity, and then they stop. Because hunting for a job when you're unemployed is incredibly stressful. It's basically rejection after rejection. I sent out 1,400 resumes. I got one response from a woman who lived in Wyoming and pointed out that I didn't live in Wyoming. And it's incredibly draining. And some people and yet, when you look at the research, like the single most important thing you can do is just keep doing high levels of job search activity. And interestingly, it almost doesn't matter what you're doing. I don't want to say it doesn't, you know, like don't draw with crayon on your wall and call that job search activity. But it's much more important that you keep doing it, that you focus on the process. That you set yourself goals that are not about, I'm going to get a job, and if I don't feel a job, if I don't get a job, I'm going to feel really bad. But rather on, like, am I doing enough hours every single day? Because it's really unpleasant, but I'm going to have to make myself do it anyway. To be in the game. We're also doing it at a macro level. So look at how we treat unemployment, right? There's the argument between Democrats who want to extend unemployment benefits, Republicans who say this is encouraging people to not work. And actually, I think that both have a seat at the truth, which is that a recent study out of North Carolina, which was too late to come into the book, showed that when they cut off extended unemployment benefits, in fact, unemployment did fall there, and it wasn't just people leaving the workforce, it was people getting jobs. But I think that Republicans misdiagnosed the cause of that, which is not that people are lazy and just want to sit around and collect benefits until they run out. It's that it's frightening. It's that when you look at the data on those job seekers, their job hunt was the worst thing in their day. And so when you have the unemployment benefits, there's a way to avoid the anxiety. There's a way to just put it to the side, and that is to say, oh, I'll do that later, to procrastinate. And so what we want to be doing, both as individuals and as society, is focusing again on the process of how we're getting people back into work. And instead we're focusing on the outcome and whether the unemployed, whether it's us or the people around us or our fellow citizens who are on unemployment, are good people or bad people? And that's not the right question. The question is, are they doing the right thing or the wrong thing to recover? I hope that the book will help America on this job seekers answer the question.
Since you mentioned you have a soy allergy, I was wondering if you've ever tried to make your own bathtub tempeh from some other tempeh.
No, I only buy strictly regulated and you know, corporate industrialized. I actually don't like tempeh, which is one of the reasons I'm no longer vegan. Once soy was off the table as a major component of my diet, it was very, very difficult to find substitutes. And I did actually have a few vegans who wrote in and said, no, I can't eat soy either, and I make all of my food and bike it into my job at this community college in Oregon. And I was like, right, but I'm running around on a reporting trip, and the only thing that I can find that's vegan and not filled with soy is Fritos, and I don't think that I can actually live on those for next week. So, we do belong to a meat CSA now. They drop off a giant, mainly raised cow once every month for us.
I hope it's been disassembled.
But home butchery is on the last side of my wheelhouse.
And I guess the other thing is, it seems when you're talking about this in terms of process, it seems like you have to really train yourself to notice the good thing that did not happen because you did not do the right thing. So I wonder if you could address that.
Absolutely. The seen and the unseen is it's an old concept in economics, and it plagues us always. Right, and you see this with antibiotics, which is one of the dangers of antibiotics, is that they're like a finite resource. You know, if I take Lipitor, Lipitor is still going to be good in 1,000 years, provided that we haven't all evolved green tendrils and so forth and changed our biochemistry. But if I take a bunch of antibiotics, my grandchildren conceivably have fewer antibiotics because resistance develops to them. And so what we've got is this finite stock, and we use it a lot. And one of the reasons that we use it a lot is that we don't take enough care to prevent infection. First of all, we overuse it because people are just, I have a cold, give me antibiotics. But doctors are getting much better about this than they were 5 or 10 years ago. But the thing that we still don't have is all of those people who don't wash their hands. And why? Because it almost never kills anyone now. Those antibiotics are still there, but 1 in 1,000 times, or 1 in 10,000, or any whatever number, I mean, you can get all sorts of numbers on this. Some number of times, your decision not to wash your hands kills someone, but you don't see it. It's not directly connected. It's very far off. And so most of the time, it's easier to skip it because you're in a rush and your hands are chapped or whatever. And everyone denies, by the way, that they do this. 100% of healthcare people that I have interviewed wash their hands every single time. And yet when, like, they're watched, it's more like 60%. And it's not anyone doing it every time. It's, you get about 60% compliance when they actually study it in small people and so forth. It's easy not to notice that you're doing it. It's easy not to notice that you are taking a risk with someone else's life, because most of the time it doesn't show up. And so both ways, it's very difficult to, when you do something right and get the wrong outcome, to tell yourself, I did the right thing there. But again, like, you can do this. There are people who are good at this. There are organizations that are good at this. Doctors actually, for all that I've been mean to them, sorry, I know them. Doctors actually spend a lot of time thinking about this. They're not perfect because they're humans, but medical industry does spend a lot of time thinking about process precisely because that's how you have to protect in a situation where you've got a lot of moving parts, a lot of people with a lot of discretion. The way that you protect is just to think about the process and not focus so much on the outcome. Right, Amy.
Okay, so you're broadly considered a person of the right. I'm considered a person of the right. I think a lot about insurance. Important to insurance is the concept of moral hazard. But I've had a thought lately. I was curious if you could share your thoughts that I think the right has gotten very obsessed with the moral part of moral hazard. So rather than just being concerned with, you know, pricing risks and appropriating that people who are going to benefit bear the potential costs, it's actually about punishing people.
Yes. No, I think that this is really... I write about this in the book. I think that we spend too much time thinking about moral hazard. Not because it's not a problem. It is a problem. If you give people anti-lock brakes, they then drive more dangerously. People in SUVs are safer, but the people around them are not, and so forth. But most cases of moral hazard are not as bad as we like to think. And when you hear, and to hear environmentalists talk, like, everyone in an SUV is doing nothing but carelessly attempting to run down pedestrians right and left. And to hear conservatives talk, everyone on unemployment insurance is just sitting there, like, waiting for the check to come so they can go down and buy lottery tickets with it, and refusing to take a job because... and in fact, when you look at things like bankruptcy, which I have a chapter on, because I think this is actually one of the institutions, in terms of picking ourselves up, is one of the best institutions America has for fostering entrepreneurship, making consumers better off, even making banks better off. I mean, it's really one of those few sort of win-win policies. In 2005, we did a big bankruptcy reform because banks said bankruptcy is going up too much, people are being strategic, they're abusing it, we need to crack down on it. And after the bankruptcy reform, it did fall somewhat, so it does look like there was some abuse. And yet, the fact is that most people who declare bankruptcy don't. I spent a week in Memphis bankruptcy courts looking at how this is. Memphis, interestingly, is the bankruptcy capital of the world. It's the bankruptcy capital of America, and America is the bankruptcy capital of the world, so it is the bankruptcy capital of the world. And so I spent a week in bankruptcy court, and you think before you go in there that it's going to be like sobbing mothers, fleeing from creditors who are attempting to like steal the last 5 cents out of their pockets. And it's like traffic. It's such a non-event. You walk in there and you say, hey, judge, I need money. And the judge says, okay, well, give them your last 5 cents and you can go. And So given how painless it is, and given how nice it would be to just have no debts, and given that people who are eligible for bankruptcy don't really have a credit rating to speak of anyway, so it's not like they're really going to lose something by getting that bankruptcy black mark on the credit report, very few people use it. Most people struggle as hard as they can for as long as they can pay their debts because they're ashamed not to. That's actually a really good balance, right? Bankruptcy is there, and it is going to be the easiest, most, even after the bankruptcy reform, easiest, most generous bankruptcy system in the world. When I tried to, I was doing an interview for this book on a completely different topic. I was interviewing an expert on Russia, and he's Scandinavian. And randomly, in the middle of the interview, he just started making fun of the American bankruptcy system. And he was like, it's ridiculous. You just need to walk in and say to a judge, I don't need money. And he's like, okay, your debts are gone. I mean, this, America's the only place in the world that does that. Which most people don't know. The Chapter 7, where you can just say, no money, and they're like, okay, no debt. This is the only country in the world that does that. Everywhere else, they make you get on a payment plan, and in Scandinavia, they can just refuse to discharge you because they think you wasted money or shouldn't have borrowed it in the first place. Or you can't get into bankruptcy at all because your creditors won't let you, which is one of the guys I interviewed for the book is in that situation. And it's actually, so bankruptcy, it turns out, how generous bankruptcy is correlated with how much entrepreneurship you have. And the problem that we were supposed to be solving was that people were abusing it. Well, what would you expect to happen when people are abusing bankruptcy, right? Credit should be contracted. And in 2005, I would say that is the opposite of the problem that we had. So, like, we passed this system to solve abuse that wasn't really happening, or that was happening. It's not that it wasn't happening, but that wasn't really creating a big problem. And instead put entrepreneurship at risk, which is the engine of our economy and which has declined in recent years, to solve a problem we don't really have. And that's, I mean, that we get these kind of really, really antithetical focuses on, is someone somewhere getting away with it? And, you know, one of the big arguments to make in the book is that forgiveness, both of yourself and of other people, and of your fellow citizens, is just a lot cheaper than we think it is. So way too much time worrying about moral hazard, and way too little time just saying, you know what, we all made mistakes here, let's, you know, learn what we can, restart the clock.
I don't like self-help books either, but I like your book actually because I really love your writing style and have for years. I'm curious about you know, as a professional blogger, is this how many hours a week do you spend doing this? Is this like a 40-hour week? Is this like a doctor working 80 hours? I mean, what's the process like?
For blogging or for writing a book?
Not writing the book, but for
blogging. Yeah. I get up around 6:30. I feed the dog. I let the dog out. By 7, I'm at my desk. By 9:30, I have sent my editor a list of stuff I'm going to write about today. By like 2 o'clock, I've decided at least one thing is off the list, and I'm going to write about something completely different that I just saw on Andrew Sullivan. But in general, then I generally knock off sometime between 6 and 7. So it's about a 12-hour day. I usually work from home. Because otherwise the commute time would extend that, kind of. And then I try to take weekends off, because otherwise I would just do nothing. It's the seduction of the modern economy. There's always more work you can do.
Given how important it is to learn to cope with failure, would you favor inducing failure in your kids or your friends or your staff or your spouse?
I would say that I look at kids, my friends who have kids, and I'm in a little bit the awkward position of being the childless person who has actually raised children, which I always love when it's people telling me about how to raise my puppy. My friends who have kids, when I was in fourth grade, I walked to school in a little group of fourth graders through housing projects. This was in Manhattan, when Manhattan was really dangerous, when like people would get shot on my block and so forth. But I would have died if my mother had walked into school. So in fourth grade, you were allowed to walk yourself to school 5 blocks with your little group, and that was the age. And now my friends are like, oh, well, 13 just seems too young to go to school by themselves. I mean, it's like 6 blocks away. And, you know, the monkey bars have been cut down to about here. And I asked them about it, and they said, well, it's so dangerous. And I would hate it if something happens. I'm like, how many of us died? Right? You would think from the way that they talk that the attrition rate in my generation was at least 20%. Instead of, at least in all of my classes, 0. And I do. It is really dangerous. It's very dangerous. And the way that we've now set up school, one of the amazing things to me in the course of writing this was when I went back to New York and I was talking to private school administrators, and they said they now have a real problem with tutors who do the work for the kids. And the parents know, and they kind of wink about it, and the school sends out notices saying, please don't hire these tutors, and the parents are like, and it's amazing to me because when I was like a senior in high school, I got into real trouble with a teacher who just didn't like me. And my parents were like, it's too bad. You know, one of your jobs in life is going to have to be to learn how to get along with authority, so you better figure this out. And that's an inconceivable thing to do now because the stakes are so damn high, right? The number of college slots has stayed, in selective schools has stayed about the same, and the population's grown, and there are a lot more people who are interested in sending their kids to a selective college. And so what we do is we set up this system where for 18 years, kids are just hovered over and micromanaged so that they can't possibly get off that track. And then they hit the real world, and all of a sudden they've never had, you know, and so you're now getting, yeah, last night I was with someone who said, we now have a problem at NYU with parents showing up to graduate school admissions interviews for business school. I mean, I don't think that a VC is going to let you come with mom. They just don't have, they're small. But, you know, it's totally understandable for the parents what you're doing. But it's also, you know, at some point the kid has to learn to fail. And when they should be learning to have bad grades and deal with authority figures that don't like them, when they should be learning all of that stuff is when it doesn't matter that much, which is when you're in school. But instead, we've turned school into this failure-free zone where if you can't hack the work, then mom will do it for you, and it's going to be too bad when you get to 25 and mom can't do your work as an investment banking analyst anymore because she's a nurse, right? I mean, this is... I do think that we need to rethink. And it's the reverse for poor kids, right? So poor kids are in the situation where basically they're like Nadia Comaneci. They hit perfect 10. They can get through the system, but otherwise they're shut out. And I think the fundamental problem is this credentialism, is this their rising insistence on college degrees for even for things where there's no obvious benefit to having a college degree, and the idea that a college degree from a selective school is the one and only ticket to the good life. We really need to rethink that because it's doing, I think, devastating things to both the elites and to poor kids.
Curiosity question. While you were writing the book, did you study or look at all at the works of Edward Stanley? And because you managed to get almost perfect design in your book.
Yes, no, I mean, the auto industry is a really interesting case study, right? Because on the one hand, you have these Japanese upstarts who come out and they're just obsessed with money. They're obsessed with tiny, tiny, tiny little improvements. And on the other hand, you have the big American auto companies that they just can't believe the magic's over, right? And it takes them so long because they can't get the internal constituency to say, it's not okay in any of these companies to say this isn't working, right? It's not okay, they just can't believe it. They can't blame themselves and so they can't bring themselves to change. And even when they do change, immediately some internal constituency comes up and kills it. So they start, like, we often say GM was this big stumbling giant. But in fact, they tried a bunch of stuff. They had NUMMI, which was a joint plant with Toyota, where they tried to use these Japanese practices. They couldn't. It did work, but it didn't work for the company. And similarly, Saturn, they revolutionized how they produced, they revolutionized how they sold, and then management let the unions kill it, because management didn't particularly like it either. That there's this inability, you know, that what the Japanese did with these try it, see if it works, like, tiny, 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 tiny improvements until your Honda with this incredible technology or your Toyota, which is the most reliable car you've ever seen, America just couldn't, because they were victims of their own success. Mr. Lee?
That's a kind of related question kind of that. So you have these large institutions that are failing. So on an individual level, it's pretty easy to say if you fail, you address it. But sometimes there's institutions like car companies or newspapers or in Detroit that's like kind of systematically failing. Which people who are kind of if you like, trapped in an institution, do as anything that kind of for us to do to make the cost of that kind of thing not so serious?
Sometimes the answer is leave. I mean, you know, at some point, if your organization is just caught in we are the best, and it's very clear that they're not, then, you know, I mean, there's this phenomenon in plane crashes where it's really important when a plane crashes. So, this is what, like, if you take nothing else from this book, the next time you get on a plane, when the stewardess is doing the safety demonstration, I want you to actually listen to it and visualize yourself as soon as the plane crashes, getting up and getting off the plane. This is, like, the one most important fact to learn in the course of all of this research. Because if a plane crashes, very rare, it's really important to get off the plane as quickly as possible and without your luggage. Because the smoke is actually what kills most people. It's not the impact. It's that there's all this toxic stuff. It flames up your whole space, and you're likely to asphyxiate. And people just sit in their seats, or they kind of futz around with their luggage. There's a similar phenomenon in organizations. It's called normalcy bias, which is this sense that things are perfectly normal, even though they're obviously not. And so you see this, you tend to think that, like, there's a fire in a theater, everyone gets trampled, and there is some of that. But there's also a surprising number of people who are just hanging out, figuring everything was going to be okay, and then just died sitting there. And you're at least as much at risk from that as you are from getting trampled. And this is similar to organizations. That what you see is people walking around pretending everything's fine. And so you turn to turnaround experts, and they'll say, like, they always get called in when someone's about to miss payroll, about to violate a debt covenant, or about to miss a debt payment. No one ever calls them in and says, you know, I'm projecting my cash flow out 9 months, and if things keep going this way, we're going to miss payroll, so let's get this going. And I asked one of them, I said, do you wish that they called you earlier? And he said, yeah, but no. Because here's the thing, before that happens, you can't get the constituency for change. Right? When paychecks aren't coming out, everyone gets real focused on what we need to do to make the payroll and the paycheck machine start writing again, right? But when it's just a theoretical possibility. So, you know, one of the things that you do is that you prepare for the crisis so that when it happens, you're going to stay in that organization. And one of the things that GM really didn't do, the worst decision that they made was that they refused to line up financing for bankruptcy. When you reorganize a company, you have to have something called debtor in possession financing, which gives you the cash that you're going to need to write out the bankruptcy process and see your other forms of debt, which is how you get someone to lend it to you. He wouldn't line it up. They're burning through cash at more than $1 billion a month. I mean, it's just arithmetic. In 6 months, they're going to be out of money, and they're going to need to declare bankruptcy. And Rick Wagner just keeps saying, no, if we line up a DIP facility, then we won't be able, then people won't want to buy our cars because, you know, we might go back with a warranty. It's like, Rick, you're going bankrupt. This is not optional because you're not going to have any money soon. So line up the financing so you have some hope for your organization. And they just wouldn't. And that's the sort of thing you really need to avoid. You need to, if you can't get the constituency for change now, you need to be prepared for the moment. You have to have lined up those factors so that when it comes and people recognize, okay, now we've got to do it, you have the resources to carry you through that. Any more questions?